The shotgun has arrived. Hold that shotgun up over here so I can get a picture of it.
I just did that for safety so you can see it's unloaded.
Yeah. Yeah.
But you can snap it together whenever.
Riding shotgun. I didn't know we... Awesome. You guys are live. Passengers are getting on. What side do they get in on?
They may want to step.
Oh, there they go. Here. The suspension is amazing. Pretty comfortable.
Right, get around in our hometown, isn't it?
Yep. Love it, Sue. Love it. Thank you. Julian Highway, heading for Julian. Delivering some passengers.
Did they have apple pies back
then? I'm sure they did. To the old church.
Oh, boy.
All right, so there's what we were riding on right there. Isn't that amazing? This is pretty much what you would see right here in the late 1800s, early 1900s.
people coming from San Diego riding that Concord coach heading towards Julian and even Lakeside. They'd pick up passengers in Lakeside. Okay, I'm gonna leave it right there. Sue's gonna be in the area and she's probably gonna park right here. She's gonna go around the block a couple times to keep chatting.
So that's it for business. Again, thank you for coming, and I'm gonna try to get a new battery in this thing while I introduce our Vice President Rob Hardy.
I'm gonna start the meeting now. Mm-hmm. I'm gonna call the meeting to order. You guys are probably wondering what these are. The original set of two that was on a freighting team wagon that had 8,000 pounds behind it, and it was a wagon and a trailer. These were on the Mussey grade. The only thing that ever scared this tough 20-year-old man named Frank Frary, who was cutting his teeth for the CB stage lines, was this. He would stop anywhere he froze with these, and he'd have to let that big rig go by. So we have Dale Redfield here. Dale and her family, and she's the great granddaughter of Frank Frary, and Frank was the mayor of San Diego in 1904. I got reached out, we kind of went back and forth on our dusty roads, and I found out that this lady knew Frank Frary, and so that's how we became friends. That was 2.5 years ago. Sil and I reached out and I said, would you do a presentation for us? And oh no, I couldn't do that, she says, okay. Every once in a while I'd ask. My wife and I were watching some football game one night, and I get a text, and I go, she's going to do it! Out of the blue, she's going to do a presentation. So then once that happened, we started getting through it, and then we had our plan for last September, and it canceled. So then I was all bummed out, and I thought once everything opened up, we would lose her, and then she decided she was going to give us our exclusive after all. So it's been a lot of work. I got to take her out on the lake yesterday. We floated over her great-grandfather's stage roads. She rode the Julian car today. And then this is the icing on the cake here to see this presentation of Frank Frary, a famous man, half owner of the Foster Frary stage lines. And this is Dale right here.
You forgot the stage line that we just got dropped off on.
Oh, yeah.
This has been a whirlwind. I wanted to introduce my family who's here, but myself first. I'm Dale Redfield. My maiden name is Erwine. My husband, Jim Redfield. And if you were in a high school band or orchestra in the 60s, your music folder said the Redfield Music Company. And we are those Redfields. My cousin, Vicki Fredrickson. Her husband, Paul. Frank's great-great-granddaughter, Kelly Williamson. And Frank's great-great-great-granddaughter, Penelope.
Can I get all of you to stand up and face this way?
All of the family?
Yes.
So, Rob was correct. This is a 2.5-year project, and frankly, no pun intended, I didn't know that much about my great-grandfather. We always knew about his cousin, who I will talk about as well, from Julian. But Frank was always sort of a mystery. We knew he was mayor, we knew he had a stagecoach, and there's evidence in our slides that showed the stagecoaches. So I'll get right into it, because it's actually kind of a long speech, because I learned a lot of things. I also learned that COVID shut down all of the historical centers, so I had to do a lot of stuff online. And I finally got into the San Diego History Center in August, and they changed their rules, so we looked at that first. So I just wanted to give credit. Many people are considerably more knowledgeable about Frank Frary's life than his descendants. Rob Harding is one of those, and our family appreciates his willingness and enthusiasm in sharing his research, as well as Tom Isom for several colorized photos. Frank Phineas Frary, that's Phineas, not Phineas, Phineas Frary, was born in the first brick house built in Fremont, Ohio on December 6, 1856, to Orrin Phineas Frary and Martha Jane Smith Frary. His father was a farmer at the time. His older sister, Mary Alice, was born on July 23, 1854. In 1868, the family moved to Lansing, Michigan, where his father became a drugstore owner and seller of sewing machines, while his sister became a teacher. Frank worked as a clerk in his father's store. On October 25, 1875, when he was 18 years old, Frank began a journey to the Black Hills district of the Dakotas. On the way, sitting out a snowstorm in Sydney, Nebraska, he rethought his plan and decided to go to California. He was enticed by the mining stories from his uncles, Almond Frary Sr. and Marshall, who lived and mined in Northern California. His uncle Almond was living in Julian by the time Frank arrived in San Diego County. Frank got to San Francisco by land and then by boat to San Diego the day after his 19th birthday in 1875, arriving with $30 in his pocket. His adventure from Michigan to San Diego took 37 days. Frank worked on and off as a handyman and beekeeper at Lou Guillaume's Capitaine Grandi Ranch, earning $20 per month as well as room and board. From his 1877 diary, he lists typical chores of a working ranch, such as clearing fields, digging ditches, tending beehives, sorting out supplies, and a considerable amount of time rounding up stray horses, usually his own. On his off time, he went to dances, smoked cigars, went deer hunting, played cards, experienced his first earthquake on January 13th of 1877, and courted several young ladies simultaneously. I played sweet on Josephine House. One diary entry relates that he and his friends walked 10 miles across Warner's Place to a feast at Mesa Grande, but got lost. He worked for Lou on and off throughout the year. He and his friend Joe Alford set up their own beehives for a short time. When he wasn't working for Lou, he stayed at friends, camped out a bit, and also lived in Lyon's house in San Diego, and I'm thinking that's probably a boarding house. He corresponded frequently with his parents, Pa and Ma, as well as his sister, Eleanor. In the February 5th, 1877 diary entry, he relates that in a letter from home, his family's drugstore in Lansing had burned down. He read voraciously, usually novels and various love stories, and he subscribed to both the San Francisco Weekly Chronicle and the Chicago Weekly Tribune. Despite the hard labor and significant distances, he was close to his family living in Julian. Almond Sr. was married to Elizabeth Farley Frary, and I passed Farley Road up in Julian today, and I'm wondering if that's some sort of connection. And they had two children, Almond Jr. and Grace. One diary entry states that Frank went camping and shell collecting in La Jolla with his cousins. In addition to the usual activities of two young men in Pioneer East San Diego County, he and Almond Jr. visited different mines in Julian. He states that the Chariot Mine was the richest. Stonewall, his uncle owned 9/11s, was a poor old mine. It is a beautiful location, but things are going to wreck. He considered leasing the Great Eastern Mine in partnership with Al Jr., but he changed his mind. But later, he briefly went into the mining business. In May 1870, Almond P. Frary Sr. acquired title to the Stonewall Mine from the original owner, William Skidmore, and his many partners. In 1871, the Stonewall Mining Company, supervised by Frary, constructed a three-stamp mill and a 100-foot shaft. Stonewall was a large and consistent gold-bearing quartz body, as much as 20 feet in width. Stonewall was on the Cuyamaca land grant, so Al Frary took advantage of the fact that the two factions of the other owners were warring amongst themselves. When one would try to put Frary off, the other would tell him he could stay. Frary put up a five-stamp mill, and mining went on all through the litigation. Ore was yielding $12 to $20 per ton, and operations continued until 1875, when all the mines in the area became inactive. In January 1876, the mine was sold at public auction to Wallace Leach. In spring 1871, Almond owned a store with Solomon Schultz on Main Street in Julian City. Almond Jr. was married to Elizabeth Malik Frary. He worked every major Julian mine, managed the Stonewall mine for his father, and for a time owned the Ella and Engle mines with his wife's uncle, Silas K. Malik. Elizabeth's name shows up as a landowner in Julian, as well as a section of the Cuyamaca City mining camp at the Stonewall mine. Almond Jr. and Elizabeth Malik Frary's home, which they shared with her uncle in Julian, is still standing, which displays a historic plaque and is currently Kathy's dress shop at 2019 Main Street. I was there this morning. I didn't shop, but I was there. Driven there in style, I might say. The mining activity in the Julian area prompted more services. The first letter mail was carried to Julian on horseback by Chester Gunn in the fall of 1870. This stage line in the slide was either owned by William Tweed or his competitor, Adolph Stokes. In the late 1873 and to 1874, heavy rains up to 30 inches destroyed transportation between San Diego and the mines. The San Diego County Board of Supervisors hired Almond Frary Sr. to build a new road to Julian by way of San Vicente Canyon and Luckett Station, cutting 15 miles off the old route, but was more susceptible to flooding. The Hamilton Express Company was the first to arrive at Julian on the new road on July 18, 1874. In July 1877, Frank walked to Flynn's, probably Flynn Springs, and after a five-minute interview, accepted a job working as a handyman for Albert L. Sweeney. Frank was a handyman and built the reservoir that's at the current stables in Old Town. I also want to point out that my cousin Vicki and her husband Paul live in Old Town and look over the Cosmopolitan Hotel and the stables. They didn't know that they had this relationship. In October 1877, Frank became an agent for Seeley in San Diego for the Seeley and Wright Coastline Stage Company, which provided overland passenger stage trips between San Diego and Santa Ana. By 1879, at the age of 23, I don't even remember what I was doing at 23, he was a driver on the Santa Ana Run. By this time, he had moved to Old Town, living in the Albert Seeley-owned Cosmopolitan Hotel, specifically Room 12, the hotel being an operational base for the stage line. In July 1882, he extended his business connections by securing a government contract to carry mail and passengers from San Diego to Julian. And in 1885, Joe Foster became joint owners of the Frary and Foster stage line. This is a very small map, but you can see Mussey grade kind of on the left. It's kind of wiggly. then it goes up to Ramona, and then up through Alina, Witch Creek, and then Santa Isabel, and then out to Julian. They continued the government contract to carry the mail and passengers between San Diego and Julian, one day up and back the next, three times a week. The route required fording the river several times, and at high water periods, the journey was hazardous. Later, they acquired the contract to carry mail to Cuyamaca. One of their five coaches was a Concord with a four-horse team. The stage line that we just arrived on is also a Concord. It's a little bit older. That one is number 89. The coach that is on display at the San Diego History Center that was Frary and Foster is number 158 and was completed on August 17, 1866 at the Abbott, Downing & Company of Concord, New Hampshire for New York hotelier Edward Hare. The price was approximately $1,250. That would be about $22,000 in today's dollars. It was next owned by John Allman, a mail contractor of Saugus, California, and was used on the Santa Barbara to Newhall Run. It was purchased in Santa Barbara by Joe Foster in 1886. The first local run was from San Diego to El Cajon, with Lakeside and Julian added to the route by demand for service. The coach was retired in 1910 and was in storage at the stable at Foster up to 1913. I wanted to point out, I do have some artifacts up here on the front counter. And on the San Diego History Center website, they have a quarterly that was dedicated just to this stage line. And it's, I printed this off from their website. I didn't have to go to the History Center. That's where I stole all my stuff from. In an 1887 article from the San Diego Union and Bee, it's described the trip up to Julian nicely in TripAdvisor style. And I'm quoting a very long quote. Leaving San Diego at 6 a.m. on one of the Frary and Foster stages, that serviceable and substantial line, so well known to the public as the El Cajon and Julian Stage Company, which has done so much in the past and is still contributing to the development of the resources of our mountainous country. 15 miles and less in 3 hours bring the traveler to the beautiful and far-famed Cajon Valley, where the first change of horses is made. Three relays, the four prancing steeds, each being required to complete the balance of the 60-mile trip to Julian, or 16 horses in all. About 10 miles beyond El Cajon, Foster's Ranch is reached, where dinner is served, and another relief of horses continue the journey up the long grade. Some 15 miles further brings the dusty and tired, but at the same time exhilarated and inspired traveler to Ramona, one of the larger of these fertile and hidden valleys which have been by nature shut up from the gaze of the superficial and less adventurous of tourists, such as Here is a fair start has been made and a nucleus formed for a wider development of agricultural resources. A change of horses is again made, and the home stretch of 20 miles of high rolling, sometimes steep, and rugged journey is preceded with arriving at Julian at 7 p.m. Time and space at present forbid special mention, which might profitably be made of many other points and places incident to the ascending journey, such as Bolina, the Santa Isabel Ranch, and numerous valleys and nooks which are well worth looking after by persons in quest of climate and location. I don't know what he's selling. The reality of the ride is stated by Martha Foster's niece, Catherine Swiecapher Lane, who said they were miserable to ride in, but pretty things. Red, not fire engine, striped with black and big yellow wheels. Even Frary related in the San Diego Union on February 18, 1883, the events after a harrowing storm. When he started yesterday morning, the wind was blowing a perfect hurricane from the east and northeast. Sounds like a Santa Ana movie. The stage swayed so violently in the gale that, fearful that it would capsize, he and the two passengers piled 200 or 300 pounds of rocks into the vehicle as ballast, which they carried until the grated had passed. One of the later drivers, Jeff Zweikaffer, possibly Martha Foster's nephew, related that the coach tipped over, experienced runaway teams, forded flooded creeks, and got bogged down in snowdrifts. They also carried bullion from the Julian mines, but there doesn't seem to be reports of holdups. The Julian stage line office was at 1427 E Street in San Diego, and they advertised as seen in this 1893 Coronado Mercury newspaper advertisement. The ad lists two routes, Foster, Alpine, Viejas, Descanso, Green Valley, and Stonewall. The other was Foster, Ramona, Santa Isabel, and the Julian Gold Mining District, which Creek and Bolena were stops as well. The fare for the all-day trip was $1, which is about $30 in today's money, and was later raised to $1.50 for adults and 50 cents for children. Frank stamped every ticket. And this stamp is actually up at the Julian Pioneer Museum. They have it in their case. Each passenger was allowed 25 pounds of free luggage. A mile an hour was typical on Mussey grade. This is the reality of Mussey grade at the time. The picture on the right shows an improvement. In 1890, the extension of the San Diego, Cuyamacan, and Eastern Railroad, part of a discussion today on the timing, as far as Foster, about 23 miles from the city, brought about another resumption of gold mining activity. Using rolling equipment borrowed from the National City in Otay, the Coronado, and the Southern Pacific Railroads, it ran trains over a line from 9th and Commercial Streets in San Diego through Lemon Grove, La Mesa, Lakeside, and to Foster. The two daily trains were met by Frary and Foster's four-horse stages, which provided a direct service to Julian and Banner. The two mining districts had been combined into one, and by 1894, 20 mines were in operation, mostly under new and stronger companies. Bolena was one of the stops between Foster and Julian. One of his passengers on that route was Annie Maud Thayer. Maud was born in San Francisco, her father a Harvard graduate lawyer. In 1883, at 18 years of age, she graduated from a Bay Area teacher's college. She submitted a letter to the Ramona School District for job possibilities and landed the job as teacher at the School of Bolena. In a March 27, 1884 letter to her employer, Maud requested that, and I quote, "Cash your warrant and send me the money. You can leave it at Mr. Thompson's express office for Mr. Frary to bring out to me." The details of their courtship remains unknown, but given the comments in his diary and her letters, they both loved to dance. They were married in San Francisco on February 22, 1886. And that's very faint, but I'll read it. "The pleasure of your company is respectfully requested that wedding ceremony of Annie Maud Thayer to Frank P. Frary, Monday, February 22nd, 1886, at 10:30 a.m. at the 27th Street Methodist Episcopal Church." And then her name is Annie Maud Thayer. She later dropped the E in the Maud for some reason, and it's kind of curious why she would drop that. She never used Annie after she got married. It's just like Maud. Frank was 29. And Maud was 21. There are records of Maud having the floor plans for a house in Pine Hills near Julian. And that's also very tiny, I apologize, but it's, I took it with my cell phone at the Historical Center. So I don't know if this house was ever built in Pine Hills. She also had on the plat map for the town of Foster, and her property is right here where it's circled, where Rob very nicely circled it for me, at 160 acres. Some of the other names are A.W. Mussey and Frank Floodgate, William H. Mall. Fascinating. This little road, that is the route up Mussey Gray. Their first home in San Diego was a cottage on 4th, near Cedar in San Diego. That arrow looks like a meteorite, but it's how specifically. That's the San Diego Harbor. Bankers Hill is a little farther. The I-5 pretty much covered this house. And that's probably Point Loma. This is the house where a close-up of it, that same house on Cedar. They had two daughters born in San Diego. Gladys May Frary was our grandmother. That's our great-great-grandmother, Frank's mother, Martha Frary, and Gladys' sister, Ruth Thayer, who's a couple of years older. Ruth was, Thayer Frary was born in 1887. And Gladys May Frary on January 22nd, 1890. This picture was when she was 13. That's our grandmother. They also lived at 2166 Park Avenue and had a house built in 1905 at 3227 Grimm Avenue, the North Park neighborhood, currently called Gurwell Heights or Frary Heights, as it was an extensive bit of land purchased by Frank and Maud and subsequently subdivided. In 1984, the Grimm Street home was designated by the San Diego Historical Resources Board as a designated historic site and is currently Carol's Bed and Breakfast, owned by Carol Dugdale and her son Michael O'Brien. At the end of his life, Frank was living at Ivy and Sixth Streets. Foster bought out Frank's Frary's share of the stage line eventually in 1898. At that time, Travis and Company underbid Frary and Foster for the U.S. mail contract for the route and sublet the mail service to C.J. Schock. Frary shifted his interests away from East County to working in and around downtown San Diego. Frank owned a draying business under the firm name of Westcott, Webb, and Frary, which consolidated in 1889 with Simpson Brothers becoming the Pioneer Truck Company. Frank was acting manager, secretary, and treasurer, as well as a major stockholder. It was the largest truck company operating in San Diego at the time. He ultimately acquired executive control of the business up until 1910. In the incorporation documents of May 1901, Frank is listed as one of the directors of the Parrott Manufacturing Company, which built wagons and buggies. He was also a stockholder, secretary, and treasurer for the Encinitas Copper Mining and Smelting Company. His signature is on this stock certificate from December 1899. And I'm quoting here, it's an article on the company. At the end of 1900, Frank P. Frary, secretary of the Encinitas Mining and Smelting Company, certified that at least $2,000 worth of labor and improvements had been performed on the Encinitas group of mines known as Encinitas claims numbers 1, 2, 3, 4, and 5, consisting of sinking shafts, furnishing materials, powder and fuse, repairing road, deepening a spring on number 4, and building houses. He was also one of the directors of the Grapevine District Dewey Mining and Milling Company in San Diego. It boasted of a capital stock of $1 million divided into 100,000 shares. Newspaper articles reflect that a major financier, backed out on negotiations and Frank's name quickly disappeared from the accounts. Since 1879, he was an active member of several societies such as the San Diego Lodge of the Independent Order of Odd Fellows, as well as the San Diego Lodge of Free and Accepted Masons and Court Palomar Foresters of America. And I want to point out that this is Joe Foster, under Frank, and then Joe Foster underneath. They were bosom buddies. He was an honorable member of the San Diego Pioneer Society. He was a member of the Team Drivers Union, but ultimately as an owner, he had to step back and became an honorary member. At the beginning of the 20th century, San Diego had a city population of 17,700. San Diego's 1901 city directory lists 606 businesses, including 11 blacksmiths, one brewery, 15 Chinese laundries, 34 building contractors, and 10 hay and grain dealers. There are 7 horseshoers, 2 house movers, 4 piano tuners, 4 language teachers, 3 dance teachers, 2 elocution teachers, and 1 sailmaker. Real estate tops them all at 55 real estate agents and dealers. Frank had always been interested in politics. As a young man, some of his 1877 diary entries pondered the national elections and various local civic events, including public hangings. At that time, San Diego had a city council run as a dual government, a board of delegates and a board of aldermen. In 1899, he was elected and served on the board of delegates for the second ward and was president of the board when he was elected mayor of San Diego, taking office on May 6, 1901. The contest was between Frank P. Frary, Republican, Patterson Sprigg, Democrat, and Frank Simpson, Socialist. The vote was Frary 1,674, Sprigg 1,000, and Simpson 157. In his inaugural address, he urges the planting of City Park, the original name of Balboa Park. Tourists, he said, are our best crop in any season. It's not enough that we have a fine harbor and moderate climate for them to enjoy if we provide no parks or shaded drives where they may rest and enjoy this wonderful climate. He pushed for an improved water supply system, garbage collection, and noted that President William McKinley would be bypassing San Diego on his trip through the West because there was no rail service from San Diego to Arizona. Much can be well accomplished for the welfare of our city should the council work harmoniously and unitedly for its welfare and progression. Midterm in 1902, at the urging of the San Diego County Republican Campaign Committee, he unsuccessfully ran for state senator. In 1903, he was reelected for a second term as mayor of San Diego. He was a staunch representative for San Diego in promoting the city's qualities. Julian Hawthorne was an author that was on tour of Southern California cities writing up different articles for the Los Angeles Herald. And it took me forever to figure out which one was Frank, honest to gosh. He looked for methods to improve the city's utilities and infrastructure. While in office, he was a delegate of the California League of Municipalities for 3 years, vice president for 1 year. In December of 1903, he was elected president by acclamation. One of the hot topics of the league at the time was the concept of cities taking over utilities. In 1902, Frank reported to the League on the 5-month progress and successful management of the City of San Diego's municipal control of the waterworks system. The League of California Cities, started in 1898 with the mayors of 30 cities, is still active, and representatives all over California share experiences for increased efficiency. In late April 1903, the San Diego Common Council adopted and the mayor approved an ordinance which authorized the Board of Public Works to lay out and improve all of City Park, Balboa Park. I wish I could tell you where something was on that, but it's the original looks much of a blur, but it looks very attractive, whatever it is. According to the plan, as designed by Yale University trained Samuel Parsons Jr., Frank was mayor for the first San Diego Arbor Day on March 17, 1904. Mayor Frary was known as a safe and stable mayor, not one to take risk. In 1905, his progressive administration helped make San Diego the first California city to adopt the initiative, referendum, and recall. After his 2 terms as mayor, he continued as owner of the Pioneer Trucking Company, as well as his active membership in his many fraternal organizations. In June 1905, he was appointed as a director for the newly incorporated General Real Estate Syndicate Land Company. In March 1911, he ran as a member of Common Council, did not win, and fell ill not long after the campaign. Frank Frary died August 16, 1911, at the age of 54. His obituary in the San Diego Union and Daily Beast states that his death was related to a severe heat spell after a visit to the East Coast. He never went to his two daughters' graduations from Stanford University, witnessed their weddings, or the birth of any of their sons. Coach number 158 was acquired by Thomas Goetz for the Paso de Estudillo in Old Town, and ultimately by Arnold Babcock, owner of the Diamond Carriage and Livery Company, and son of Elijah Babcock, builder of the Hotel Del Coronado. He donated it to the Pioneer Society of San Diego County in 1925, where it was stored in the industrial building in Balboa Park. On the first anniversary of the Serra Museum, the Pioneer Society donated the coach to the museum. At 2 o'clock on Wednesday, July 16, 1930, it was moved up the hill to the Serra Museum in the Presidio. But not until it was dramatically horse-driven to the Presidio, proceeding west on Laurel Street to Fifth Avenue, down Broadway to Kettner. From there, made it way to the Presidio. Quite a promotional stunt. The coach's life at the museum was rough, as it was parked outside and was subject to too much public handling as well as the elements. After finding significant damage, including a collection of vodka bottles and beer cans, an executive committee decided in 1960 to move it inside, requiring enlarging the main doors of the museum by 9 inches. Volunteers worked for almost a year to repair the human, weather, and wood borer inset damage with a fresh paint job, upholstery, lettering, and striping. It was moved to the current San Diego History Center in Balboa Park in 1980. For many years, the image of the stagecoach was the logo for the San Diego Historical Society. The Frary Foster stagecoach has been a legacy to the Erwine family, Gladys's descendants. Many of us have the chance to sit on the driver's seat or inside of the surviving coach. That is my brother. That's my dad on the left, Vicky's dad in the middle, and that's Maud sternly telling them not to fall out the windows. And then she actually let them get on top later. So that's my dad, Sam Erwine on the left, and David Erwine on the right. This is my brother, Dan Erwine. And if you ever listen to KPBS or KFSD for the last 40 years until he retired, he was a radio broadcaster on those stations. That's me. And then the next one. This is also us a little bit later. So it's kind of beat up a little bit. Frank and Maud had 4 grandsons, 8 great-grandchildren, and continues on with a little one up here, and 2 little ones. Really little ones up in Washington State. This one is Dallas McCormick, who is now, 32, something like that? So he had his opportunity. His brother, Dakota, lives in San Diego, has moved from Colorado to San Diego. In the 90s, our family donated funds to refurbish the lettering and striping on the coach in the History Center and enjoyed a reunion centered around the stagecoach. I've enjoyed getting to know Frank beyond what I'd heard passed down from my family. He was definitely someone who was driven to have a hand in the future of San Diego City and County. I think my cousin has a few words she wanted to say, too. Yeah, you did. You said you wanted to say
something. Well, I just wanted to thank everybody for coming, and I wanted to pay tribute to all of the people that helped put on this event. It's been a 2-day event for us. And so if anybody is in the audience that helped,
our driver this morning.
Yes.
Fortunate to go out to the lake yesterday, and this is part of Mussey Grave now. The stacked stone is a remainder of what was placed there 140 years ago, and in town. And this is Rob telling us essentially everything about the universe. This part of San Diego County. He knows every rock, he knows every bush, he knows every glass point. Fabulous. If you can get him out on the lake, he and his friend Tom, do it. Does anybody have any questions that I can try to answer? I also know that I posted on the Frary Family Association Facebook page the poster for this program, and I think a few of them might have. Are there any other Frarys in this audience? From Alpine.
Can I borrow your light?
I stayed at the Julian Hotel. That was pretty cool.
They used to put 9 people in here.
No way.
9.
No way.
Yeah.
They
were a lot smaller.
They sit on.
They were smaller people.
They were smaller people back then.
That's fucking. Oh, okay. Flew in a hot air balloon, a helicopter. Sat co-pilot in the Ford tri-motor airplane. Now I sat in the stagecoach. Okay, I'm done.
Now we need to ride in one, right?
Yeah, really.
Turn it back around.
I co-pilot seat and tri-motor.
Yeah. I've never ridden in a helicopter.
Yeah.
Nobody would see her.
Hot air balloon helicopter.
Hi there.
Tri-motor. I sat in the
We have one lined up, just not this one.
A real Ford tri-motor.
Good.